I was brought up in a very musical home. My mom was a pianist and eventually a concert pianist. The first piece of contemporary music that ever came into the household was from the 1957 Broadway musical of West Side Story. And my parents got the album, and I basically commandeered it. And I remember, having never seen West Side Story, I could see it in my imagination. I was 10 years old when I first listened to the album, and it never went away. And I didn't see any reason why something that's been performed thousands of times on stages all over the world, which is West Side Story, couldn't have more than one motion picture made of it.
We started in 2014, and Kevin McCollum had the rights to the stage musical. So he knew that we could go to the estates and Stephen Sondheim and get the rights. And they were not willing to give this movie over to just anyone. And so Stephen had to win him over. And it's interesting. I mean, he's one of the greatest filmmakers of all time, but he had to work for it. And they were impressed with what he had to say. They knew after talking to him what his love of the musical was and why he loved musicals so much. And so we had a few meetings with them. There were things that we couldn't change. There were things that we had to work around, and we were in for all of it because we just wanted to make a fantastic musical.
Gather around for champagne. All right, well, this is a tradition on all of our movies where we toast the first shot and we toast the last shot. And we have been actually in production on this for months. The choreography, the dance rehearsals, the music, the orchestrations. Gustavo Dudamel and David Newman conducting the New York Philharmonic Orchestra. Janine Tesori's work, getting everybody primed and ready to sing these great songs, as great as anybody has ever sung them. And this is all to say that there's been 4 or 5 months of production already on West Side Story. But now, the production to actually bring all those elements together as one voice into an ensemble, into a relevant story to the times we now live in. I'm just so proud and honored that I got this shot. I got a shot late in my career of being able to tell this story directly based on the 1957 Broadway musical. So I want to first of all thank Tony Kushner, who was the one that made this possible. And Christy McCosco, who pulled this entire production together over the last 3.5 years.
Christy!
And our whole crew and cast. Gosh, I'm so proud to be here, and thank you all, and let's have a great safe shoot.
When Arthur Lawrence was alive, he always said, we really need a genius of film to remake West Side Story. And I said, what about, you know, Steven Spielberg?
I had a deep abiding love for the original Broadway musical, and I have been challenged by what would be the right musical to take on. And I could never forget my childhood. I could never forget the first piece of popular music that was in our house in terms of a 33 and a third LP record, and that was the Jerome Robbins conceived West Side Story.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1. 5, 6, 7.
Are we good?
That's where it gets lined up.
He came up to me at a premiere party and he said, you know, I've always wanted to do West Side Story. I said, up to you. If that's what you want to do, do it. He's a wonderful director, obviously. He's passionate about the piece. That's what bodes well about it.
Show me that position, and let me see what it looks like from this angle.
Mr. Spielberg came to us and the representatives of the Jerry Robbins and Arthur Lawrence estates and asked whether he could make this film. We were so honored and thrilled.
Imagine just sitting at a table with Steven Spielberg telling you that all his life he's wanted to direct a film of West Side Story. You know, you can't say no to that. My father saw Close Encounters, and boy, did he love that movie. He thought it was so brilliant. He loved the idea of the music being the language. He was just beside himself.
So the camera's on a crane.
What Arthur said to me was, if they make another movie of West Side Story, which I hope they will, I want a writer who will respect the essence of what I wrote, not the particulars. He'll recreate the cake, not the frosting. When I met with Steven Spielberg about it and talked a long time, he said to me, in terms of a screenplay, the one I would most like to work with is Tony Kushner. I thought, ah, well, check, done.
I knew that Steven really loved musicals, and he said, I want to do West Side Story. My first thought was, you're out of your mind.
We're going to sing, aren't we?
Yes.
Yes.
Tony and Steven push each other in good ways that always make the film better.
We have to take that romantic liberty.
It is, in a way, it's what Shakespeare did. I said, I think if you really want to do West Side Story, the next person you should be talking to is the choreographer, because this is not only considered to be the world's greatest musical, but the world's greatest dance musical.
Getting a chance to make something with Tony Kushner and Steven Spielberg and an incredible cast has been just really amazing.
Okay, let's do it.
Every production of West Side Story, of course, is theatrical, it's theater. And even the Robert Wise movie, which I adore, is still a hybrid between theater and cinema. I kind of wanted West Side Story for us to be as street real as humanly possible. And Adam Stockhausen, the production designer, really made that possible by finding some extraordinary locations.
And action!
The iconic snapping of the fingers. Yeah, I mean, you can't have West Side without snapping fingers.
I want to see where your hands go into the snapping.
Since I was a little kid, you know, been practicing snapping my fingers. It was funny, though, when we actually went to record it in the booth, and it was time to put your fingers up to the microphone, you start to get nervous, and they get all sweaty and sort of like looking at each other, trying to get it on the beat and everything.
And action!
The city of New York is a character in the movie. Adam Stockhausen had to work with Steven to find great locations, which was really important.
The Jets' part of the neighborhood was in the active process of being knocked down, and we ended up finding a great site in Paterson, New Jersey. To do this, it was a couple of parking lots that were flanking a road, and we were able to build the destroyed area. and to see undestroyed buildings with a lot of period character, and it really added to what we were able to construct.
The prologue is the very beginning of the film, so it's a way of introducing dance as a language for telling the story to the audience.
Guys, this is from when the first ba-ba-da-da.
It's a really important number in that sense because we're saying this is a means of expression for these characters, and join us to embark on this journey together.
Like that, that's great, that clears riffs. Great, that's gonna work.
Steven's astonishing plastic imagination about how the camera can be used and how planes and angles of perception can be part of the dynamism of a scene. I thought this could be like marriage of cinematography and choreography unlike anything anybody had ever seen. And I thought that's what could be really, really exciting.
Bigger.
And top row.
Also, there's no singing in the prologue, so it's really all about music and dance and telling the story.
You know, I think what the prologue kind of serves is this buildup and story of the Jets and the Sharks and like the dynamic between the two gangs.
Jets.
The Jets are going around and kind of terrorizing the neighborhood, but it almost seems as if it's, you know, a regular Tuesday for them. You know, it's like, what kind of mischief can we get ourselves involved in with the Sharks today? And it just so happens that they're going to deface this mural.
Divisions between unlike-minded people is as old as time itself. And the divisions between the Sharks and the Jets in 1957, which inspired those four geniuses to, you know, turn, you know, current events into a musical. Those divisions were profound, but not as divided as we find ourselves today, which I think in a sense, sadly, made the story more relevant to today's audience than perhaps it even was in 1957.
Really good.
Catch cut. That's great. That's all I do.
You get the sense that all these Puerto Ricans within the Shark gang, they've all come together to protect their culture and protect the community that they're in. And the Jets also have their same reasoning. They want to protect their culture.
The Jets have been doing this with the Sharks for some time. Little things here and there. And I think everything's just been building up and building up and building up and building up. There's some heat here, and there's some animosity here with both groups.
Separate! Separate!
But at the end of the day, we're just telling stories about people. That will always stand the test of time.
This is Bar 16, and...
It took a year to cast the film. We looked at 30, 35,000 individuals. For Bernardo, I wanted somebody that could be a street leader based on his gravitas. So David Alvarez came in, and he was a wonderful actor.
La Borinqueña is the revolutionary anthem of Puerto Rico, which was banned in the 50s, and you were not allowed to sing that in Puerto Rico.
I had read The War Against Puerto Ricans. It's a brilliant book, so I decided to put Libertad, the Puerto Rican flag, with a light blue, not the dark blue. And then here you have Viva la Revolución, Viva Puerto Rico Libre. That's what I think Bernardo feels every day.
Despierta de ese sueño.
When I read in the script that he was singing La Borinqueña, especially the revolutionary words to La Borinqueña, I said, oh God, I love this.
It's all about fighting for your freedom and fighting for your rights.
For them to sing this, and for this to be the first sung material in West Side Story, the movie, is really quite something.
Break quiet, please. Here we go. Roll sound, please.
Puerto Rico lives in its language and in the works that have been written in that language. And so the Borinqueña is sung in Spanish. And I just wanted as much Spanish as I could get Steven to stick in. And every line of Spanish first got translated by Julio Monge into proper Puerto Rican Spanish.
Mi hermana es muy cute.
Right.
¿Dónde está mi hermana?
Exactly.
It goes down, it's dry.
I didn't want it subtitled. English-speaking audiences will figure out basically what's being said from the context and from the reactions.
We're not relocating.
Nosotros vivimos aquí.
We have rights.
Tony Kushner, along with Steven Spielberg and a couple other people, they wanted to add this to the film to give importance to why the Sharks felt like they needed to defend themselves.
Rights, huh? What are they?
We wanted to bring that into this movie because this is something that Puerto Rico is going through today.
Despierta, Borinqueño. Que han dado la señal.
La Borinqueña is just the indigenous people that lived in Puerto Rico. Boricua is Puerto Rican, so La Borinqueña is just the whole title of just saying us Puerto Ricans.
Singing it every single time, every single shot. Like goosebumps, crying, man, it felt good. It felt really good.
El ruido del cañón, nosotros queremos la libertad. Nuestros machetes nos la darán.
¡Viva Puerto Rico libre!
Something that was incredible is that we got to shoot the same week that the huge protests were going on because of the corruption that had been happening in Puerto Rico. So we all felt that energy of fighting for your rights and understanding why it is that we created the Sharks, why it is that these characters are here fighting for their freedom, for their values, their morals, their culture. And La Borinqueña was a perfect way to present that.
La libertad. La libertad.
It was just like such a moving, powerful song.
Made you really feel so proud to be
Puerto Rican and to be representing
representing Puerto Ricans in this movie.
As they walk away, the next thing is the Jet song.
Something that happens here where you guys are a bit in awe. You're just feeling something. You know, quite, you can't quite put your finger on the feeling, but it may resemble something like begrudging respect.
You can almost see Mike Faist making this decision. Okay, well, we have a song of identity too. This is ours.
We want to talk about the Jet song. That's the one we're getting ready to do.
All right.
Right?
Yeah.
Let's just focus on jaw, chin, lower teeth. See, I don't want to get caught up in dialect. It should be the thing that you want to say, and the dialect is just going along for the ride.
The amount of care that's been taken from just the beginnings of the language. Every day, the question of, is this right? Are we doing this right? How can we bring it closer to what's authentic?
You know, it's like muscle training. It's absolutely muscle training. Use your muscles in a different way.
Right, this is what we're gonna do. We're gonna go line by line. Why don't you kick it off for us?
So when you're a Jet all the way.
Mike Faist is a soulful, deep thinker, you know, a deep feeler as a human being and as an actor. And his dancing was off the charts. His dancing was spectacular. But it's when he read the part of Riff, I knew after the first reading on video that I wanted to cast him.
So go into I'm going the more U. for like a ch- sound, cart chew away.
It's not about the sound.
Oh, okay.
Cart chew away.
A chew, you want a chew.
Yeah,
I got you, I can give you a chew.
Yeah, yeah.
Chew I'll chew on it.
Uh-huh.
There may have been like a little over 3 months of rehearsal period, 8 to 10 hours a day, every day, spending time together. I'm really grateful for that time because that was where the Jets really did the majority of their bonding and figuring out, like, who are we gonna be together and let's get to know each other.
Because we had such a long time together, like we've all been together for months. So when you sing together, it's not just singing together, it shows the pact that you've made with each other. It dramatizes that pact.
Let's just do some breathing. Close your eyes.
Janine Tesori was in charge of all the vocal direction. You know, we started out going to a studio to lay down all the tracks.
Just take a breath, focus.
This is so exciting.
Great, you go, everybody on mic.
What I think is really cool about this bunch of Broadway performers who Steven brought together is no one I feel like has experienced something like this on this level.
Let's do one more, you guys. I want you to cheer him and taunt him.
From the rehearsal process to being on set every day, it's been a lot of performers and artists who are just thirsty to learn every day. So it's created a really cool work environment.
When you're a Jet, you're the top cat in town.
You're the gold medal kid with the heavyweight crown.
Okay, thank you. That was it.
Thanks, guys.
The most amazing part of those 3 weeks of pre-recording was sitting just on my left with Stephen Sondheim, came to every session. But primarily it was Janine working with the singers and Stephen advising and me just sitting there feeling, how lucky am I that this has fallen into my lap and just being grateful that I was getting the chance to make West Side Story.
I actually auditioned originally for Tony. and then they asked if I would come back in for Riff. When I first sat down with Steven and we were kind of talking and getting to know each other, you know, I kind of said to him, like, the movies I grew up watching were Singing in the Rain and West Side Story and, like, Indiana Jones. Like, those were the movies, you know? So I told him jokingly, I was kind of bred and groomed to, you know, do this with you.
We have a couple other Jets who want to meet you, too.
Oh, yeah.
Mike, if you want to.
I'm the old Riff. When you're a Jet, you're a Jet all the way.
Oh, wow.
I really wanted to get here and pat him on the back and bless him, you know, like it's like in a relay race, you know, where you hand off the baton and he takes on it.
I'm gonna go check the shot. Yeah, I gotta go back up, check the shot.
You kids are young, you're gonna do a lot of different roles the rest of your life, but you'll never forget West Side Story, because once you're a Jet all the way, from your first cigarette to your last dying day. Walk tall.
And don't smoke.
Let's try one more.
Great.
One more time, please.
Take three.
Where we began with the Jet song is the Jets are on the brink of losing, really, each other, because they don't have anything left. and nobody really is gonna have anything left here soon. And the entire Jet song is to try to get these guys back to the only thing that they really know, the only thing that's really been keeping each other safe.
When you slide, man, you can stay in this position like this.
Sondheim is a kind of a genius.
Yeah, I understand.
The more time I spent with the lyrics, the more blown away I was by what he had done. I began to realize how rich and complicated, even apparently simple lyrics like When You're a Jet are. For instance, the first verse, it's all about protection and a dangerous world outside.
When you're a jet, if the spit hits the fan, you got brothers around, you're a family man.
Then in the second verse, it flips very quickly to we're the kings of the world, you're the top cat in town, you're the swingin'est thing, you know, etc. And then in the third verse, that joyful narcissism spills over into aggression.
And we ain't kidding.
So you really have a portrait of child development from being a young, vulnerable kid to a kid in a gang who feels protected so that his sense of limitless possibility can explode. That excitement and exhilaration spills over into a kind of rage and a desire to destroy things. And that's in this one little song.
So that's fine.
Let's do one more.
All right.
One more time. I got
one more
shot.
Finishing out the Jet song like that, climbing up this hill on this incredible set, all these people you love. What, I mean, just an incredible moment.
When you see that shot and the pullback of these Jets, you actually see what it is exactly that they're claiming, which is not theirs anymore. Also, not really much to begin with.
On the whole, ever, mother-loving
city. It felt unbelievable, and singing it felt unbelievable, but to then go back to Video Village and watch it all together with Steven, it was a really, really special moment, and I will never forget it.
Steven said to us that, you know, we've just kind of marked our flag, that this is our version of West Side Story.
That's like taking a flag and going like this. This is our version.
We're putting the stake in the ground, and you've proven that we can claim this as our own in these modern times.
Jerome Robbins directed and choreographed West Side Story. I would say that he was one of the great artists of the 20th century. His great gift was that he told the story through the choreography. I don't think anyone had really done that before. He did that really naturally. If you look at the dances in West Side Story, they really tell the story.
The artistry of dance in the gym is Justin Peck and his assistant choreographers, what they did. I watched it go up on its feet in the rehearsal hall, so I watched it evolving into something very special and very different than any other production of West Side Story on stage.
My approach to creating this for film was to choreograph a number from start to finish. I wanted the performers to be able to experience a sense of what the entire construction of a particular number would be.
I've never rehearsed the way we rehearsed on West Side Story. 4 months of rehearsals, maybe even longer than that. It gave me a chance to figure out how to put my camera to all the dance that was being designed by Justin Peck. And so I was coordinating my iPhone with Justin's dance steps, and I would cut that together to the music, and I would look at it cut together, and then I would go back and reshoot it a second time, finding different ways for the camera to become a dancer. So I was storyboarding on video, and I was storyboarding, as I usually do, hand to paper.
Take a moment, breathe. You'll never experience anything like this.
I related more to Dance at the Gym than any other number because that was the big ensemble number. The dance is about getting that energy out through dance, through movement.
The way that I had to communicate to each group was very different. The Jets came from a background of a lot of training and a lot of experience, and so many of the Sharks, the amount of experience they had was very little. And so we didn't want to make anybody feel less than, and at the same time, we knew we needed to create a balance between both gangs.
The Dance at the Gym could be the movie, as far as I'm concerned. On one of the days before shooting, Justin and Steven just let them do the whole dance sequence. But to see it live happening was breathtaking.
It's a dance-off between Puerto Ricans and the Jets.
Roll cameras, please. Roll.
Who are Irish, Polish, Italians, and a mix of other cultures. And all of a sudden, it gets separated, and everyone starts to show off their skills, their culture. It was really great to see the battle going on between two different styles.
We looked at a lot of gyms because we had so many dancers that had to fit in the space. We didn't want it to be enormous. It had to be intimate enough to hold the dance, but large enough to work, and it needed to have bleachers. Steven and Tony had the idea that Tony and Maria would actually meet underneath the bleachers while the dance was taking place. But that was shot at Steiner Studios. And then, of course, it needed a stage, had to have good entrances for the Sharks to come in, because the Sharks' entrance into the dance was a big event.
Each of the dresses is different, and they are able to hold the gang together as a group, and fabric was chosen to do just the right thing, so that it was engineered so that they will open up, and it would give Justin everything that he needed for the movement.
Where's Paul Tazewell?
To be shown the appreciation of the people that are going to be wearing the clothes was very, very moving.
We also want to thank Paul's whole team.
Paul was certainly a new kid on the block because I used so many of the same people over and over again, film after film. But I loved Paul's work. He designed all the costumes for Hamilton. And I loved his work on a few movies he made. And I really wanted to work with him on this.
Oye, Javi, ponle fuego. Vamos!
The second Paul said, we're going to do a black dress, the red petticoat, I said, sign me up.
I chose to go with black because I didn't want for it to be reflective of the other productions that I had seen. And her petticoat is red, so there is this internal fire that's going on for her.
Anita's a very strong character, but Bernardo can stand up to her. Their dynamic is different from Graziella and Riff. That extends to the respective gangs and how, like, Bernardo leads the Sharks and how Riff leads the Jets. It's a big part of the storytelling through dance.
I consider myself a pretty immersive and method actress, and little did I know I was meeting my match. I said it was very important to me. When we're at work, we are together. I want to build this physical relationship with this person, so when the camera's rolling, it doesn't look forced. So when I expressed that to Mike, he was 100% in for it.
We just had a blast on creating that young love that is not great. I remember she told me, whoever the leader of the Jets is, that's who Graz would be with.
We were given a lot more depth to Graziella than in previous productions, and getting that opportunity to be more than a dancer.
The Dance at the Gym was 60 dancer actors and 150 extras, and some very, very ambitious shots that involved a lot of people, a lot of moving parts, and oftentimes took a long time to capture.
Every time you deal with a whole bunch of people in the frame, it's a nightmare for a cinematographer because we wanted to create that sense of deep focus. So that requires tremendous amount of light. This was the movie that had to be sharp all the way from the foreground to the background to reflect the beauty of the story, to reflect the beauty of the dance.
The New York Philharmonic played the Mambo with Wayne Bergeron, who is one of the best trumpet players in the world. We even extended the trumpet solo so Wayne had time to really blare and hit some extra high notes.
The amount of excitement for this moment that we're living is so huge that I don't know how hours pass and I just keep dancing.
My sister passed away when I was 3 and she was a dancer. And so I danced for her. She's the reason that I dance.
You're dancing 14 hours a day in hot heat, nothing but sweating everything out.
I was melting. A lot of the guys get to take off their jackets. I was not one of those guys. As hard as it is, as exhausted and completely emotionally and physically spent as we are during those weeks, unanimously, there's no place we'd rather be.
I just felt like I could be free. It was pure joy and an important message about clashing points of view.
Everyone was just clapping and cheering, and Steven was just giving everyone hugs, and everyone was so excited to be there and to continue filming.
I was so jealous. I wanted to dance with them, but I had to go be moody Tony, who's not in the mood to dance. And there's Maria.
For Maria, Steven did want for her to have a white dress for the dance at the gym. She is representative of light, innocence, and newness, definitely, for Tony.
The bleachers with Tony was shot before dance at the gym. So my first day was not supposed to be my first day. It was a weather cover day, but I got called the night before and I was like, here we go. I was incredibly nervous. I remember telling Ansel, I was like, I feel like we're at my screen test all over again.
Rachel is a prodigy. She has become one with music since she was a kid. I think parading around her bedroom, listening to musicals, it's effortless for her. Rachel comes on, first job, just turned 18. She's laughing and joking around before every take. All of a sudden, she's doing the scene perfectly.
Cut, great.
Cut.
That was Rachel's first shot in the film.
¿Dónde está mi hermana?
Maria! We want the audience to feel enticed by the story, entertained by the dancing, and on the top of it, really make it beautiful and a little bit more authentic. Shooting on film was really the only way to do it. It brings you an element of reality. It fits that period, and saying cut and reset and reslating, it's good for everyone. It's good for actors. It was great for dancers because dancers would get a little break. It's a good discipline that goes with this particular movie, which was full of really precise movements and dance choreography. So it was perfect with the process.
Not yet. Now.
At the end of Dance in the Gym, I couldn't believe I was never going back to that high school. I would never see that gym again. It was so sad. We had a blast. It was early in the schedule, and Dance in the Gym helped us realize the kind of movie we were making.
This is the end of Dance in the Gym. 7 days of shooting, you are a permanent part of the West Side Story Company forever.
The high bar was set by Rachel Zegler on the first day of casting, and I just kept looking and looking and looking, and she was the bar that no one reached. I could not believe that somebody who could sing as well as that and was of Columbia descent, how could I be so lucky to find her on my first day of casting?
I started performing when I was 12 years old. I always wanted to do it on a professional scale. I wanted to make it my job, make it my life. And part of me never thought it was realistic. Now it's my reality, which is crazy.
Rachel and I have now known each other for more than a year. And she came to us with a beautiful voice. There are young people you meet, and their ears are so big in terms of their curiosity, their interest, and their ability to learn on the spot. When I first recorded Rachel more than a year ago, she had never done a session before. That was the beauty of starting with a 17-year-old. She brings that openness, and we would work and work, and then I've watched her come of age.
I played Maria when I was 16 years old for a regional theater, and it wasn't until about 6 months later that the audition notice for this film went out. My friend McKenna Reynolds from California sent it to me, and she said, "Remember me when you're famous." That night, I sat down and I sang "I Feel Pretty" in Spanish. And that video is somewhere. I know that Steven has it. And it's embarrassing, but they saw it and the rest is history. It was the hardest year ever of just waiting. And it was a lot of self-doubt, a lot of wondering if I was good enough to do it. And it took 6 more months to get cast. And so we were at this dance studio, and Steven walks up to me and he's like, "I want to let you know that you've gotten the part of Maria." And I screamed, "Holy shit!" That moment was really incredible.
Oh my God.
It was an amazing day to give her the part. And also the other important thing was I knew what a good person she was, not just because I got to know her a bit during the casting process, because I got to know her mom and her dad, who were two wonderful people, generous and supportive. And I basically knew based on that that she was going to be great in the movie. I had met Ansel a couple of times, and he sort of stuck in my mind, but I had no idea he was a singer.
It was a no-brainer in terms of wanting to do this movie. I just had to prove to Steven that I could sing. So I started working on Maria, but I didn't quite nail the song, but I started sending in tapes anyway. The casting director, Cindy Tolan, kept saying that she wasn't going to show those tapes to Steven, but to keep trying. So I sent in so many tapes, because Maria is a really hard song. Leonard Bernstein wrote it like an opera. And I hadn't sung opera in a long time, so I started working with Giulia Mitsunova, who's an opera coach. And we did hours of vocal exercises and sang Maria phrase by phrase for months.
The first day he came to audition, he was sick and his throat had closed down and he had congestion in his sinuses. And he didn't cancel the audition, he just went for it. And yet his voice was in another register that was too high for the register of Tony. Once I found out that he had been ill and didn't tell anybody he was under the weather, I had him come back in 5 days later and retest, and he got the part during the retest.
Maria, I've just met a girl named Maria. And
for the number, Maria, and other outside scenes, the first question I think was really, does this want to be on the streets of New York, or does it want to be indoors on stage? And Steven's very first direction to me was, get it outside, make it real. And knowing that that was the mission led to a whole series of conversations about what does the West Side look like now, what do other areas in New York look like now, and while we're at it, let's just look at all the other possibilities. Let's look at other neighborhoods and freestanding backlot sets in different cities around the world.
The song Maria takes Tony all throughout the city on his journey to go discover what he's feeling. And it starts internally. And then it becomes, I gotta find her. And then he's through the alley yelling for Maria because he thinks this might be her neighborhood.
We went to a real alley, but the idea of then carrying on all night long to do the whole song where there are helicopters going by and traffic noises and people trying to sleep, there are so many restrictions that we knew we wanted that to come to a stage set. We built that set in a warehouse at Steiner Studios, and then we used every inch of it.
My wife's name is Maria, so my favorite is Maria, because my love is Maria.
Maria.
Guinness?
Just stunned that you found her. You.
They've built the fire escape that we're going to climb inside the soundstage, and it's three stories up. And I kept pleading, please don't put a harness on me. I can climb it. Just put a big pad in case I fall, which I won't. But they're putting a harness on me. And we did a rehearsal the other day. There's a whole aspect of danger that comes along with it. Tony almost teasing Maria a little bit.
The balcony scene, I sang in my audition piece on tape. And that's going to be the thing we wrap with, is really nostalgic and emotional for me, because I feel like it was the first thing I did. And it's a beautiful scene, and it holds the charm of Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet. So to wrap with the song is gonna be a nice little ribbon.
Dream of me.
America goes to a lot of different places. We saw it in the script and talked about, oh my goodness, America's a challenge. It starts in the apartment, but then it goes and travels through the entire neighborhood. So we had a series of large street sets.
Puerto Rico, you lovely island.
It took 10 days to shoot America, and there was a heat wave. it just became part of the feel, part of the character of the song, to have to perform this very vibrant, empowering song when it's like a hot, sweltering summer day.
And the money owing, and the baby's crying, and the people trying.
Ariana just came in. The first thing I noticed about her was her dancing. The second thing I noticed about her was that she was shy.
I love it. That's fantastic.
But I saw somebody who had tremendous personal charisma. And I kept thinking, once I get her on video during these rehearsals, I bet she doubles down on that.
Nobody knows in America, Puerto Rico is in America.
And it's exactly what happened. She actually quadrupled down on what I felt was very magnetic in the room, and it just blossomed on the screen.
Come here.
And then eventually I just said, she's Anita.
Once I got the job, Steven was like, you are her, and she is you, and you don't really have to try. I just want you to be, and she'll come out. And you know what, he's right. I wanted Anita's voice to be imperfect. Janine Trezori and I found our way into understanding that there's a freedom in her voice, but there's also a deadly fact in her voice that has to come through. She's a woman ahead of her time, and that really is a big part of the conflict. She's strong and very much of the mindset that I will always love my home, but I am not going back to Puerto Rico.
I like to be in America, okay, by me in America.
And Bernardo was like, but things are better there.
For a small fee in America.
I'm honored that you're in on with me.
I'm going to be the owner of a fabric shop. It's a cameo, and it's probably only because I was a Jet 60 years ago. But it's really absolutely brilliant that I've been asked.
They do pre-records before we're doing a scene, and those pre-records will play back into their earpieces when we start filming. We'll do a few pieces to playback so that the actors get into it, and then we'll switch over and go to live.
Oh, that's perfect.
Andy Nelson and Gary Rydstrom were doing the post mix on it. They were more concerned about really getting as many sound effects, about getting the best vocal tracks possible. So Jerry and Mike, who worked with me, they would put microphones all over the place, and we would capture cars, cranes, and everything else that was going on while we're doing dialogue.
Buying on credit is so nice.
Make sure that the background always had something exciting to do and new and authentic.
What do you have though to keep clean?
We got it.
We created photographs exactly. In the Puerto Rican area, we would have a piragua cart and pretzel carts and hot dog carts, things that we felt like would be there.
In a room in America.
I basically said, I'm not telling the story unless every shark can be from the Latinx community. I don't want to do what's been done on every stage production that's ever been mounted, which is basically to just mix and match. I wanted this to be an all Latinx cast. We have, out of 50 cast members, 20 are New Yorkicans or Puerto Ricans or descendants from Puerto Rico. So I did as much as I could. Christy McCosco did as much as she could, and Sidney Tolan, the casting director, and Tony Kushner, to marshal this edict and never break that rule. And we didn't.
Better get rid of your accent.
I have felt so connected to my Cuban roots on this project, being surrounded by so many passionate Latin people.
If you're all white in America.
It was a majorly ambitious number, and the script took many of the numbers and put them into different contexts and applied different storytelling. And so it would be impossible to use the original choreography.
While Justin Peck was going to do his best to honor the legacy of Jerry Robbins and Peter Gennaro, he is his own man, and he has a very specific style, which I will tell you, it's very hard to conjure out of your body on concrete, but it's beautiful.
The three of us auditioned in Puerto Rico.
I had the ballet company with him, and I used to go to a studio.
With me.
That it was with him, so I danced with
basically,
both.
Basically, David knows everyone.
Here we go.
The shark women are empowered. They are fearless. America is all about that sentiment. We want to live our dreams here.
I'm from Puerto Rico, and my dream has always been to come out here and pursue this. So I'm really in character because it's what I'm feeling. It's just brought so much confidence in me.
You forget I'm in America.
I didn't have the good fortune to grow up with my Puerto Rican father, so I had to constantly search for who I was. So one of the gifts this movie has brought me is the gift of acceptance of who I am, and to be accepted by the Latin community, by the Hispanic community, and more importantly, by the Puerto Rican community.
It's rather difficult to go on the brightly lit streets at noon with hot, harsh light, having dancers and making it glossy. You have that bright top light, you get big shadows on people's faces. So you end up bringing many big lights. And you've got 100 degree weather, and then you're bringing lights that increase the temperature 120. So you have to think of that.
The third day got so bad that we had to cancel the shoot.
I think I go back to San Juan.
The costumes also had to be lighter so you could dance in them and be realistic.
For the sharks, we had 15 men, 15 women, and then 400 background extras. It was challenging, but hugely gratifying. We had an amazing team.
There's a moment where we explode into the streets. It's full of energy, it's vibrant, we're sweating, and it's great. Ah, it feels amazing.
My copy of America looks like a Ram truck went over it. It's filthy and it has smudge marks on it, and it really represents what it takes to film a musical.
It was an incredible experience. You see people looking outside their windows.
It culminates in this massive intersection. It's almost like old Hollywood moment.
It was very fun, and I wouldn't trade it for the world, making this film outside in the streets of New York.
The whole point of ending America with a kiss is because no matter how different they view this world, that kiss brings them together.
My father was writing Candide and West Side Story simultaneously. He would shelve one to work on the other, and there was a bit of cross-pollination.
What if you do turn and then...
One of the songs that was meant for Candide ended up in West Side Story. It was Krupke. Krupke began its life as, where does it get you in the end? In the end, in the end, in the end. It was in Candide, and it didn't quite work. So it moved over to West Side Story and became Krupke.
Hey, Mark.
G Officer Krupke takes place in the 21st Precinct. So instead of being out on the street, they've pulled the boys in for questioning. We shot at church in Brooklyn, and it was sort of the right size and shape and had the right bones. We totally redid the floor, repainted the place, built in the interview rooms on the sides, and did a bunch of work there, but the structure of the space was a great start.
A little lower, please. That's great. That looks very much like you're in trouble with the law.
Officer Krupke, it's a funny song about children who have been exposed to violence and drugs and crime their entire lives, and that's what's turned them into juvenile delinquents. They make fun of it, but there's a seriousness in the song underneath, and the song is important in terms of explaining how the Jets got to be the Jets.
We missed you.
It's a story told in dance, in physical proximities, and with the beautiful Sondheim lyrics. It is a classic song, but also it's a song that I needed that song to make a point.
I want to be able to hold this, including Doris. You don't have to cheat Doris.
It's a different context in this particular film in which the gang get brought in by the police to get questioned about where the rumble was happening.
Hey, Krupke, you made a mistake.
She ain't a jet. She nags us all the time.
A-Rab, he'll start up anything just to kind of get someone riled up. And that someone is anybody's.
You say, go suck a pickle when you...
For anybody's, I think Steven definitely wanted to consider people who were appropriate in today's time for that role. If we can cast a trans person in this part, that is what I would like to do.
Roll sound, please, roll.
We've always heard people say anybody's is the first trans character in American musicals. There's something that's gender questioning or gender fluid about the original conception of the character.
Tony told me I could take on any four of you.
Arthur was ahead of his time with this. He said, anybody's is a character who was a man born in a female's body. End of story.
I ought to be a chick.
That's great, because that's what really gets you mad. It's challenging what you want more than anything else.
I have always questioned the gender of anybody's. It felt like to me, it was a trans character. Of course, I'm a non-binary trans person, so I'm always looking for representation of myself or my community in musical theater.
The camera's gonna move past that. Go ahead, let's do the dialogue.
Tony Kushner so generously wrote a whole character background for each of us.
Tony was incredibly helpful with helping us differentiate our relationships and going that extra mile with our characters and how we got to know each other and how we got to become a Jet.
That's good.
Anybody's is really trying to find his way. We see this kind of lost soul hoping to join this gang of brothers, not only to be accepted into a family, but be accepted for who they are as a person and accepted in their own skin.
And action!
Through a series of events, Anybody's escapes, and all of the 5-6 Jets that are there are left in the precinct alone.
Sit yourself someplace and don't move a muscle till I get back. Don't even sweat, you hear me?
That was great. That was so funny.
I saw it as a kid in a community theater production. The one thing I remember is the Officer Krupke number. It's such a jaunty, fun, and catchy tune.
You put the hat on like this, try it on your back, and then you turn, great shot of your face, take guard, want to try something like that?
I think it was Janine's idea to just slow down the first verse. But saying to the audience, you have to listen to this as well as enjoy it.
Here, kindly, Sergeant Krupke, you gotta understand. It's just our bringing up key that gets us out of hand.
It makes you enter the song in a slower and more cautious way. And also, for everybody who knows all these songs by heart, it's going to be startling.
Gee, Officer Krupke, we're very upset.
That's where I want to make the cut.
I think at the center of Krupke is Baby John. The way the Jets show Baby John, how the system works, going to the judge, then to the psychiatrist, then to the social worker, makes it come alive.
There is good, there is good, there is untapped good, like inside the worst of us is good.
And Janusz and Mitch, I just want to shoot it overhead, and I'd like to see the whole jail.
Steven had the idea of wanting to shoot the bulk of the number in like 4 or 5 shots. So every move, every transition had to be carefully and densely constructed so that the cast would just land and click and flow right into the next verse that they were singing.
Many occasions I felt I'm on Broadway watching a really superior musical, so it was a very luxurious place to be. Because I was among them.
We love Yano.
We're disturbed. We're the most disturbed. Like we're psychologically disturbed.
As soon as we started doing Krupke, I fell in love with the choreography. Justin Peck. I don't use the word loosely. I say he's a genius.
Try and connect with each other in there later. Yeah, like almost like you're giving each other the signal with your eyes.
It's fun and it's happy-go-lucky, but the tone of the entire number is really sad and is very angry because it just shows you how broken our system is.
My father is a bastard.
Krupke's a little different in other scenes because there's a really long shot. It was amazing to feel that love of performing because you're getting to do 20 seconds of a number.
Goodness gracious, that's why I'm a mess.
There's a movement in the song into deeper and deeper levels of dysfunction and defiance and rage. And we wanted to make it clear that you're not just watching a bunch of adorable guys clowning around.
We are sick, we are sick, we are sick, 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 like we're sociologically sick.
Very easy to work with them because I knew they will hit the mark, because if they're not precise in their move, they'll crash into each other and you have a big disaster. It's almost like watching stunt people with much more panache.
See this right here? See the Mount Rushmore? That's the shot here on them. Okay. With all three faces like this. Yeah. See that?
Kevin, who played Diesel, we worked together for 2 years straight, like before this movie. We found out we got this movie together, freaked out, we're so excited. I've always known he's a great performer, but to watch him just take a dive into the role of Diesel firsthand was awesome.
I think you can really like play this to each other. Yeah. Like kind of get in each other's faces.
Good, good. I love the smile.
Krupke has evolved to more of a storytelling. Life is hard. Sometimes the system can help, but other times, you're gonna have to grow up and be the adult.
Like the best of us is no dead good.
The very end of the number, you really can see the anger behind it all.
The trouble is he drinks.
The trouble is he's lazy.
The trouble is he stinks.
The trouble is he's growing.
The trouble is he's grown.
Krupke, we got troubles of our own.
Still a number about thumbing your nose to authority to kind of have their own say about what's happening in their lives. Krupke's not there, but Krupke gets to come back and see all the damage they've done to the precinct.
Officer Krupke, Krupp you!
The first thing I shot was cool. So much is spoken based on the physicality of Riff and Tony and how their friendship feels like it's coming to an end, and the fact that the whole thing is keep away and it's playing keep away with a gun.
Let's rehearse with the cast, please. Here we go.
Nice, quiet, please. We're lining up.
For cool. In the original film, it's in a parking garage, but discussing it with Steven and with Tony Kushner, they had the idea that this would be in the old crumbling West Side piers, where they could be jumping from broken shard to broken shard of this crumbling structure out over the river and have physical danger support the emotional danger of what the scene is about.
We'd seen renderings of the set. We've seen like full-scale models and pictures, and finally seeing it in person, it was hard to believe how much detail went into every like barrel or beam, and it was basically a playground for us, honestly. We were so ready to just jump in and swing on everything, and Steven was actually really nervous about us going on set and horsing around, because naturally we're just a bunch of kids, that's all we want to do is play on this big jungle gym.
Just this light, first light, pin it away. The set was built in such a way that it's almost like a ribcage of a whale. It's a resemblance of old cargo terminal that through the years became decayed. So it was very skeleton-like. That created opportunity for me to create shadows on people's faces. And when people go through shadows, it creates a kind of a staccato movement, so you feel not at ease with it. So the dust, the flares, the smoke, the water, I would spray the streets to make it more glamorous to some degree. But all those elements are part of the storytelling.
As they come toward us, adjust, then they've got a clear frame.
Watching Steven Spielberg start filming Cool and turning and saying, I am terrified, was a great place for all of us to start. Being incredibly honest about how scared we all are. Because you just want to bring it. You want to bring your best self.
I just want to run this camera. So I, with a longer lens, just reach out.
I was scared when I knew I wanted to make West Side Story. I was nervous about all the obvious pitfalls and traps of making a movie that most people would consider to be a jumping the claim of Jerome Robbins and Robert Wise on their brilliant classic movie they made in 1960, 61. I was certainly nervous that people wouldn't care that we didn't use the movie as a reference, we only used the original Broadway show as a reference, that we would be basically accused of remaking a classic that won, obviously, numerous Academy Awards and tremendous box office and just enjoyed such great, deserved popularity. But I had my own way into West Side Story.
Got a rocket, your rocket. Keep coolie, cool boy.
It's such a profound story. It speaks to every generation. It's timeless. Everybody should be reminded of that story as often as possible. So I didn't feel like I was claim jumping. And I think enough time has passed that our West Side Story can stand up on its own.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
To start off the filming process with cool, the tone was set, the energy was set, the rhythm of how things worked on set was set there. It opened up the team. It's like we were all holding hands.
The whole crew was so excited. Steven was so excited. The amazing ensemble of Jets were sweating through our clothes and giving everything we had. It was a great way to start the shoot.
Boy, boy, crazy boy. Get cool, boy, got a rocket.
I'm typically used to working with the theater stage, so it was a little bit challenging to figure out how to rehearse the number, and we were battling the elements. Cold certain days, hot other days, 1 or 2 days it rained, so we had to reschedule some things, but we accomplished it.
Boy, boy, crazy boy, stay loose, boy.
I'm really glad we started with cool because it was a very challenging number, very ambitious number. We were outdoors on this epic location. It was exhilarating. It was such a great way to start the process of this film.
That was great.
Tony and Steven and Justin decided to make it about the relationship between Tony and Riff. We get to see the competition between these two guys.
9, 10, 11, 12, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
That's where Justin's expertise really came through. How do we dance a number while at the same time showing all these nuances that are happening with these two guys?
Ansel really has to dance in this version. Cool is a big dance number for him. Traditionally, Tony doesn't dance. He does a little bit in Dance at the Gym, but usually it's just a singing part. But we were able to work really hard and get him prepared to execute this really demanding role.
Cool escalates with all the amazing music in the instrumental section into this dance on a pier that Justin Peck has choreographed so amazingly. And Steven adds all this action, and there's dust being kicked, and it all makes sense in the story.
Put a little dust right under his feet and also under Sean, so when Julian's crouch, when he gets up, he does this.
Sure.
If you walk.
It's a bit like kabuki theater. So much is spoken based on the physicality of Riff and Tony.
Come down, what you'll do is you'll come down, and you'll go down to the gun, and then you go whip up to their face.
Ansel and I really worked hard on developing that relationship for one another. Crafting that was a very special time, for sure.
Steven Turner said, it's like action movies. It's really true. Activating a musical number is key. The song brings you from one point to another. It's actually a domino series.
In the end, Riff gets the gun and runs off.
Boy, boy, crazy boy.
I remember Steven coming to me very excited about the edit. He brought Patricia and I into the cutting room and showed it to us, and we were just blown away.
Just play it cool, boy.
Watching that with Justin, I knew that Steven was gonna bring great dance to film.
Okay. And then if it's wrong, we'll do it the other way.
It took patience and a tremendous respect for Leonard Bernstein, Stephen Sondheim, Arthur Lawrence, and Jerome Robbins. I'll be almost 75 when the film comes out, and I realize I guess you can teach an old dog new tricks.
Pow.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, then one more time.
John Williams was the one who advised me to hire Gustavo Dudamel to conduct the orchestra. There was no direct role for Johnny in this, but Johnny was very, very instrumental in making this all sing.
Can we play violins that cha-pa-pa-pa-pa and try to imitate in your ears have to be the castañuela sound? Okay? When I was around 15 years old, I was in a conducting class where we did some arrangements of I Feel Pretty. The music conquered me immediately. It's so natural for us to feel connected to this pure and unique music.
He's the biggest conductor going now. We're really lucky to have him, and he was a great choice to do this.
I Feel Pretty, which is one of my favorite songs in the show, comes after the death of Bernardo and Riff. The next thing you hear is, you know, bum, 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 ba da 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 ba. And I thought, that's so daring. Watching Maria sing I Feel Pretty, she's the happiest she's ever been. And we all know what she doesn't know, which is that her life is over, that the man that she loves has murdered her brother. And I started crying when I first realized that. What a brilliant bit of dramaturgy. So I called Steven and said, you've got to promise me that we're going to do that. I am pretty, wonderful boy.
Ladies, when you do the la 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 la, it just sort of releases into the air. Cool.
West Side Story, they were my first set of professional lyrics. I Feel Pretty uses language that street kids would not use, like alarming and charming, rhymes like that. But I wrote it because almost all the other songs had either very few rhymes in them or rhymes like day and may and bay, and I wanted to show that I could do rhymes of two syllables, let's put it that way, and internal rhymes, things like that. This was, I thought, would show me off, and it was entirely wrong, and I'm embarrassed about it to this day. And I actually wrote another lyric. It was a much simpler and much more straightforward one, and Arthur and Jerry and Lenny would have none of it. They loved the song the way it was. Not me.
Okay, Rachel, put your phones on check levels.
I'm very proud of the songs that I gave a new setting to. When I said to Sondheim I could make him like I Feel Pretty, what I meant was, what would a Puerto Rican teenager in 1957 do for a living? She'd be working on a late night cleaning crew. So I thought, what if she's in Gimbel's in a big department store and she's surrounded by banners that say things like witty flair on autumn wear and pretty and witty and bright, you know, that's where she's getting those words. And she's also parodying it because she has to clean up after all of those sophisticated, witty people. So she's making fun of it.
She thinks she's in love. She thinks she's insane. Hi, she isn't in love. She's merely insane.
Walking into Gimbel's for our first rehearsal was one of the most fun days I think we've ever had, because she's just teasing her friends, being like, I'm happy and you guys are working and I am in love. I love the way we start I Feel Pretty, because it's a self-realization that she feels beautiful, and she's just kind of looking down and just, I feel pretty, oh so pretty. I feel pretty and witty and bright, and I pity any girl who isn't me tonight. And it's just fun. Ah, oh, it's beautiful.
I feel charming, oh so charming. It's alarming how charming I feel.
But Adam Stockhausen seriously topped himself. Adam's set is the star of that song. There's no detail missing. There are perfumes, little lipsticks, and all of these incredible signs. It's just beautiful.
Such a pretty face, such a pretty dress, such a pretty smile, such a pretty me.
It was all about reflection. I mean, the song is I Feel Pretty, and Maria is seeing herself in mirrors through the course of the song. It's really exciting to have Maria working at the department store. My mother actually worked at Gimbel's. So to dive in on this one and to recreate Gimbel's was very exciting.
That's really good. I love it.
I love it.
I first started by finding store fixtures that would have been appropriate for the period, and then I had mannequins designed, because there was no 50s mannequins available, and I needed so many of them, so I had them designed and built and sent here.
She has pretty eyes.
Then the art department built a lot of the scenery that we put them on, and it was quite an undertaking, but I think it looked great.
Everybody walk this way, one step, right there.
Steven always has a vision, but it was really awesome to see the vision change. He's someone who's very open. He likes to collaborate. He likes to hear your ideas. And what do you think Maria does in this scene? What do you think her reaction is? And we have a conversation about it. There are days where we just try a bunch of different versions and he gets to pick in the editing room which one he likes. I'm so thankful to work with him on this, my first movie.
Rita Moreno was Anita in the original film, and when Steven told me Rita was involved, I was thrilled, because someone who comes from theater, it's all about legacy and honoring the shoulders in which you stand on.
I'm just thrilled to pieces. Wow.
Thank you.
You knock me out, baby girl. You do.
When I first heard about this film, I was really, really nervous. And then my agent said, Steven Spielberg wants to talk to you. And I said, he does? Well, I'm too old for Anita, that's for sure. And he told me he would love to have me in the movie.
It was Tony's husband, Mark Harris's idea to change the character of Doc and have his widow be Puerto Rican and have her be Rita Moreno.
And it's not a cameo. It's a real, honest-to-God part.
This is so extraordinary. You can't imagine hearing this music again. It just makes me... I almost feel tearful.
Having Rita in the movie gives you that legacy to some degree, right? Clearly, she's an iconic figure, not just in the world of Broadway and dancers, but for the general audience, you know? Having her on set made the movie much more special.
This is the first shot of For Valentina, played by Rita Moreno!
And I thought that she really needed to be the executive producer. She needed to serve more of a managerial role, not just to come in as an actor, as a part of an ensemble, but to really help us frame the messages that West Side Story needs to extend to people who see it. And she's been very, very causal in all of that.
You are wonderful. That is a beautiful, where'd you get that voice?
She has lived and breathed West Side Story. She migrated from Puerto Rico into New York City when she was 5 years old. She lived a New Yorican experience. She is New Yorican. And so he thought to himself, I'm gonna have really young actors and I need somebody that can guide them with lived experience. Why not give the cast the gift of Rita Moreno?
It's only just out of reach, down the block on a beach, maybe tonight.
Rita is old Hollywood, which is such a cool thing to be around. She is totally herself, which is a great energy to have when everyone's trying to make something artistic and it rubs off on everyone else. And it's a contagious good feeling that Rita brings with her wherever she goes.
You're beautiful, you two. Oh my God, you were meant for each other.
Richard Boehmer was in the original movie and he came to this movie set. And when I saw him, I burst into tears. I didn't expect that to happen.
Wonderful. Good to see you.
I've come full circle. I just can't believe it. I cannot believe what an extraordinary experience this has been.
For Rita, it was important for her that she not come off as feeble. You know, I originally designed mostly dresses for her, and one of the suggestions that she made was that she would like to wear a pair of pants and the first thing that she would be in, which makes her appear more active in a way. She's actually restocking and taking care of a lot of the things around the store. And I thought that it was a smart choice for her.
You know, Valentino, so all of this business.
We were thinking about if she is playing 70 years old and her husband probably died 10 years ago, ago, and he's had it since the 30s. We wanted it to look like a store that was opened in the 30s and had very few renovations done over the years because people didn't renovate the way they do now. So we had the marble countertop and the old soda fountain fixture, which was from the 20s. And then we added a few modern elements to it because maybe something broke and she added a little bit of formica to it because it was the 50s. And a lot of pictures of her and her husband and memories that she had over the years owning it with Doc.
Quiet, please.
Here we go, clear an eye line back here.
Please, no one behind camera here.
Somewhere was used as a ballet in the original production. I remember seeing it as a ballet. And the singer was in the wings. You didn't see the singer. Tony Kushner thought of putting Somewhere in there at one of the most difficult times of the movie for Valentina to sing. To me, it's almost like a religious song. It's such an extraordinary song, a song of belief and hope.
I want to go up to the mirror to see you, just looking at this picture. But then your eye just goes up and you see this picture. We go up through that reflection, and then we get much closer on you too.
Okay. There's something about this woman who's now 80, who has been through the history of the 20th century of the United States in popular entertainment, won an Oscar in the original film, you know, has had this extraordinary life. And you think when she's singing it about this vision of a world that's beyond the meanness and stupidity and bigotry of the present one, and it makes you think, and I knew it would, of what's changed and what hasn't changed in the life of both Valentina and Rita Moreno.
So let's do it from the top then. There's something so haunting about a very tense moment in a film, and you hear just, there's a place for us. And then the orchestra starts to sneak in.
A time and place for us.
The idea is to sound raw and devastated. You know, she's devastated by the news. I mean, it's almost a cappella. It's with a held string note and a piano.
I'm not singing it. It's something she's saying to herself. It just happens to be set to music. Do you know what I mean? I wanted it to be an emotional experience. I wanted her to feel that somehow, somewhere, there has to be a place for us. We should have been shooting.
Yeah.
Working with Steven Spielberg, it's one of the great thrills of my life. He's really an actor's director. He just rings it. He rings the drama and the emotion out of this, and he knows how to do that. With me, he kept saying, hold it back, Rita. Don't give it away. Don't give it away. Getting to that emotion inside me and touching it and using it and then not allowing myself to express it, except in very, very subtle, intense ways.
They say, Tony, you don't faint right away, just look at them.
Yes, then. There you go. Absolutely, that's great. That is great.
Good.
I've never been asked to do that, because after all, I'm Hispanic, right? And I will always, always be grateful to him for giving me that in this film.
Cut, break that shot. Rita is wrapped.
No!
Which is sad, because I don't want you to be wrapped.
Can I just say it's been a privilege. I am so proud to have been, oh my God. I'm so proud to have been chosen.
Every block of Lincoln Square, every inch of San Juan Hill.
I want the West Side locked down.
The quintet is a real challenge. All the characters make music together, but they're all in different places.
The Jets are gonna have their day tonight. The Jets are gonna have their way tonight.
For the AD, Adam Sumner, the biggest challenge was to create a schedule that allowed for the story to be taken from one place to another through the course of the day and yet maintain the schedule.
We're gonna cut them down to size tonight.
the song has a quick rhythm. It's a battle rhythm. It's before the big fight. You have to bring that rhythm in your movement, in your acting, in your singing. That rhythm has to be there.
We're gonna shoot the insert. Great.
Steven storyboarded it. I realized that he was doing two things. He makes it all about velocity and about the sun setting and light. And it's a masterclass in directing.
Well, baby, get it. Well, baby, got it. And we're the ones to stop and once and for all tonight.
Small chunks would take place in one particular location. So you're constantly moving the dancers, but it has to be part of the same dance. So that's a big challenge.
Anita's gonna get her kicks tonight. We'll have a private little me.
That's pretty good shush. Pretty good shush. I know shush. And that's good shush.
Tonight won't be just any night.
The quintet is just a beautiful assembly of many carefully planned out shots of two gangs, of Maria, of Tony, all sort of interweaving and preparing for the rumble and preparing for this evening and preparing for the moment where everything's about to change.
We can move back like this.
The quintet is a monster of music, and Steven's storyboard for it has remained the same. He showed me that storyboard, I think, on day one. And in one shot, I pass the jets. We just miss each other, and it's an incredible shot.
That's pretty great.
It's probably the most exciting musical number. It makes you understand what the gift of Leonard Bernstein and Stephen Sondheim have, which is that energy. There's no getting out of the excitement.
The jets are coming out on top tonight.
It's a fascinating moment in the movie because there's so much going on with each group where on the one hand we have the sharks that are feeling threatened and feeling pumped and ready to take on the jets in a way that really proves to them once and for all that they deserve to be here. The jets probably in the same kind of mentality as well, and Riff is really needing his boys and doesn't feel like he actually can be the leader, but he's having to step into this role and kind of fake it, even though he doesn't really want to.
Janine was incredible at analyzing what the message of the song was, what the energy of the song was, and making sure that the actors could apply that message to the song.
By the time you get to the end, they're all doing counterpoint, much like you do, say, in an opera.
Charisma I can take.
Yay!
Good. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Great.
Kill the lights.
Tony wanted the rumble to take place instead of underneath the West Side Highway, to actually have it in a sanitation shed where road salt is stored during the summer to be used in the winter. And so we were looking for this enormous space. We actually found the site here on the Navy Yard property. The other critical requirement was that it had to have a lot of windows because Steven wanted to feel the presence of the highway the entire time we were shooting the scene, to have light kind of strobing through as cars were passing on the highway and to have that repetitive light element be a driving feature of the lighting for the scenes.
You're in the shadow, let's get some light on you.
It's very expressionistic and the image really plays important part of this particular story.
This is the first thing we see after the quintet is this image. It looks really good.
The rumble was physical and emotional. We always had to be out of breath. So everyone is doing jumping jacks and push-ups and just running around and trying to be as physically present as possible. So that way when we start the takes, it feels like we're really in it. It was intense.
And action!
We wanted to make sure that there was not the same dance fighting that you see in the original or on the Broadway show. We wanted to show the real peril, and we wanted to show that these are two gangs, they're out for blood, so we want the audience to really feel that they're at odds with each other.
And that's all I need, cut you.
I had to take boxing lessons for a couple months, and we did some stunt training to learn how to fight for camera. And then we did stunt training to learn how to fight with weapons. And then we applied all of that to the choreography that we were gonna use for the fight scenes.
They understand all the elements of stunts. They just had to be
taught the fundamentals, and they all just wanted to soak everything up.
Yeah, that's right. Three, and then you stop on the fourth one. That's good.
Creating that knife fight with David and Mark Fischera was really something that the three of us crafted together in a way where we wanted it to show that both of these guys were scared for their lives, as opposed to just trying to kill the other person. And we wanted to add in these elements of real fear.
Right, that's what it needs. That would be perfect. Right into his arm. That's great.
They were so diligent about infusing their character into it. And the fights morphed over time, which was really fun.
It's one of those magical things where you find elements and pieces of yourself that you didn't know existed. There was this instant kinship that kind of washed over the both of us.
We all know West Side Story. We all know how it goes. Needing to watch Mike Faist get stabbed just over and over and over again, and the tears in his eyes and just like the helplessness of it. Everybody was crying. And I didn't expect that to happen at all. It was really a somber experience.
That was the most physically taxing week of filming I've ever done, but so rewarding. 6 days of filming, all at night, all from 6 p.m. to 6 a.m.
We were tired, we were hungry, we were getting angry, we were fighting, but it was also this huge sense of camaraderie between all of us that we felt.
And let's rehearse the whole thing from coming in. Let's rehearse all the light changes.
When they did the play in 57, Jerome Robbins didn't want the Sharks and the Jets to commingle or to have any relationship outside of the written structure of the book on stage. I respect that very much, but I wanted these guys to enjoy each other, enjoy the richness of the diversity that was happening by bringing these two sides together in rehearsal and on set, and they became best friends.
It was really surprising the way that we embrace our characters and our stories and how we could switch the hate that we're supposed to feel for this group of people to the love that we have learned to feel for those people during the production.
So wild how much we hate each other on camera, and then here we are just like it's a field day.
None of us are leaving this the same people. That's because of Steven. What I witnessed was a person who is just chasing his joy.
This was a joy-filled experience. I haven't reached the apogee of such joy on every movie I make. There was something very special about this that I can't even put into words. It's just a little bit hard to articulate. The feeling this gave me and the closure it gave me, having lived with these songs since I was a 10-year-old boy growing up in Arizona, and to have been able to fulfill that dream and keep that promise that I made to myself in the back of my mind, and that my wife, Kate, kept bringing back to the front of my mind to remind me, don't break that promise to yourself. You must make West Side Story. I'm grateful, and I'll be grateful forever.
All the sharks are totally silhouetted.
He's just the perfect artist because he remains a student. That really was infectious for everyone. It allowed everyone to kind of come and approach the material from the same mentality of just chasing your joy.
When we did the unfortunate final scene on the streets of Paterson, New Jersey, it was the dead of night and it was just this heavy atmosphere.
Tony Kushner wanted Chino's character to have a full, complete arc. And so a lot of work went into making him one of the main characters of our story. And Josh Rivera came along and filled the bill perfectly.
The first time I held the gun, it was kind of terrifying. I didn't like the feeling of it. And I tried to use that because I think underneath all of it, Chino doesn't want to murder him.
Chino!
But he feels like he has to.
We're doing my death scene. Steven asked me to speak to Maria. He said, just talk to her, tell her you love her. And I went into her ear and I said a bunch of things. And I kept speaking to her until she felt something.
I remember breaking down. How does she move on? How does she get over it? It's a conversation Tony Kushner wants to have with me after we wrap. What Maria does now. Where'd she go?
I realized I'd made a little bit of a problem, which is that at the very end of the movie, Maria is supposed to sing Somewhere, and she hasn't heard the song. So where does that come from? And then I had this idea that maybe it's not the right song for her to sing, because what she's saying to him as he's dying is, we'll be together again in some wonderful place. And I don't know if she believes that. So I started thinking about the intro to Tonight.
You're the only thing I'll see forever.
That's what she really should sing to him, because she can promise him that. I will never let you go.
You.
We kept doing the scene, and Steven said, keep the camera rolling. And then he whispered something to Rachel. There was something about that, and her acting is so beautiful.
How many bullies are left?
It really hit me in a way that made me feel actual legitimate remorse. At a certain point, kind of wasn't paying attention to the camera. I was just locking in on Rachel.
I can heal now because I hate now.
Steven said to me, I want you to hear Tony telling you that it isn't the way. He's like, I want you to hear him talking to you. It's beautiful. I had chills when he said it to me. He was just like, I want you to hear him.
There's such a darkness and a lot of hate, but the hope is that these women do carry on, but that they do it in a way that transcends bitterness.
The final shot is showing the Sharks and Jets working together through a tragedy that brought them together, and it took some extreme thing to make them see the light, but the last message is them exiting together as one.
West Side Story is a story about love, unconditional love. It's about people in the margins who are just trying to find their place in the world and hold on to love where they could find it. It could be Tony and Valentina, love between Maria and Anita, brotherly love between Riff and Tony, Bernardo and Chino, brotherly love amongst the Sharks and amongst the Jets. It's about love and how it can carry you through. It can destroy you, but it can be your saving grace.
We saw Steven every day doing what he loves to do. He had such a passion for this material. And we all knew how important this movie was to Steven, so we all brought our best selves to every day on set.
And cut. I've been preparing for this moment and not prepared for this moment. On most productions, when we've reached the last shot and we have our ceremonial toast, I'm pretty happy to go home and get my life back. And this is one production I never wanted to see end. I have had the greatest time making West Side Story. And people would ask me like years ago, okay, you've done a war movie, you've done a shark movie, you've done a UFO movie, you've done an adventure movie. What haven't you done? And I've always said, a musical. And no one's taken it seriously. Well, I hope this time they take it seriously. We couldn't have done any of this without any of us doing the best work we've ever done. God bless all of you. So thank you for everything. Okay, it's a wrap for David, Ariana, and Rachel. Okay, I think we should do the last shot. I'm leading Rita to the precipice of a slate.
I did the final clap for the final take of West Side Story, the original. So I asked Steven if I could do that. He said, absolutely. He said, I love that.
And so we set the shot up, and Rita came in and she slated it. And then we did the shot, and it was perfect on the first take. But I wasn't ready to finish shooting West Side Story. I made Rita go back in with that slate because I wasn't willing to say it's a wrap.
Take 2. Take 9. Take 12.
And if Rita hadn't finally stood up and said, okay, this is enough, it's great, I would have kept shooting that night because I did not want this experience to end for me.
Take 14.
I don't want the movie to end. What can I tell
you? Okay, here we go, guys. And wait up.
Cut. Print, check the gate, and wrap.
I was 25. I wanted to write music, but my mentor was Oscar Hammerstein. He'd been a surrogate father to me and also really taught me what I know about the theater and about lyric writing. And he wanted to do a musical based on Romeo and Juliet in contemporary terms. That's all there was to it. Nobody was out to, quote, change the theater. And in fact, West Side Story didn't change the theater. But it was a unique piece, and it was a great example of content dictating form. And the form of it evolved as we wrote it. I learned from Jerry the difference between real time and theater time, which I could go into, but that's a long name. I learned from Arthur about writing scenes. And from Lenny, I learned essentially how to be less square. Most of those stories, of course, are either exaggerations or just made up, as like all showbiz stories. Nothing very dramatic happened in the writing of West Side Story. The New York Times rather liked it, although they left me out of the review. Everybody else got credits, but as far as the public was concerned, the actors made up the lyrics because I wasn't mentioned, and that hurt me a lot. And I'm still annoyed with that. His inventiveness about how to treat the songs and how to change things in the story. You know, a lot of people who think they know the piece are going to be surprised. I think this movie is really exciting.